Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to Opera 101. I'm Dimitri Pittas, the Artistic Director for Holy City Arts and Lyric Opera, also known as HALO, and this is Opera 101 Conversations. Before we get into our conversations, I have a little housekeeping to do, and I hope you'll bear with me. Next week, on March 2nd, there will be no class. I'm sorry. I hate to do it. I hate to do it to y'all. I hate to do it to myself, but it's just, we've got it. There's too much going on, and we're just going to have to skip next week. But fear not, because the following week on March 9th, Margaret Fournier will be back, and she's going to be lecturing on the wonderful composer Benjamin Britten with a focus on his, I think, his greatest opera, although other people will disagree, and that's fine because opera's subjective. It is Peter Grimes. So we're really looking forward to having Margaret back in 2 weeks. And many, many, many apologies for not having class next week. That doesn't stop you from going to our YouTube channel and checking out one of the other classes that you may have missed. You can go to YouTube and look up Holy City Arts, or you can go to our website, holycityarts.org, and click on our Opera 101 page where you can see all of the classes that we've given and the links to watch all of those classes. I'm also really excited to announce that Will Berger, who lectured on the Tales of Hoffman a few weeks ago, has agreed to a 5-class lecture series that we're gonna call Devouring Opera from Soup to Nuts with Will Berger. We're really excited about this as well. You can see over there that those are the courses that he's going to be giving. We're really excited for that too. You know, the origin of the phrase from soup to nuts is from the 1800s, and it's used to describe a full course dinner. Now, back in the 1800s, those dinners were 4 to 16 courses, but we're not going to offer that many. We're only offering 5, but don't worry, because each of them will quench your appetite for opera and will leave you sated, but not uncomfortable. Or as I like to say in the food world, uncomfortable. I'm trying to patent it. I'm not sure if it's gonna work or not, but you know, that's just when you kind of feel like those last 3 bites you shouldn't have had and you're just kind of getting a little uncomfortable. Don't, you know, if you can use it, it's fine, but just make sure that you give me credit for it. Anyway, I would like to introduce our guest today in an unorthodox manner. Greatest entrances of a voice in any opera, as far as I'm concerned. With a heroically shining tone of exceptional clarity and precision and gorgeous burnished power, American tenor Russell Thomas uses his signature elegance and intensity to create vivid character portrayals of the world's most important stages. Russell has essayed so many of the great Verdi tenor roles, such as Don Alvaro in Forza del Destino, Radames in Aida, Manrico in Trovatore, Adorno in Simon Boccanegra, Ismaele in Nabucco, and the titular roles of Stifelio, Ernani, Don Carlo, and of course, Otello, as you just saw. Equally comfortable outside of the Verdi repertoire, Russell has sung bel canto roles like Donizetti's Roberto Devereux, Bellini's Norma, as well as Mozart's Clemenza di Tito and Idomeneo, and Puccini's Tosca, La Boheme, Beethoven's Fidelio, and Mascagni's Cavalleria Rusticana. Russell is frequently heard on the concert stage in Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, Verdi's Requiem, and Mahler's Das Lied von der Erde. He also created the role of Lazarus in the world premiere of The Gospel According to the Other Mary, a passion oratorio by John Adams and Peter Sellers, and has recently accepted a position as an artist in residence with the LA Opera through the 23-24 season. esteemed guests and lovers of opera, it is with great pleasure that I introduce to you an artist and a friend, Russell Thomas. Russell, thank you so much for being here today.
Hello, thank you for having me.
We were kind of chatting a little beforehand that it's been quite some time since you and I have actually gotten to chat, although I've seen you perform on stage prior to that, which is amazing. How are you, first of all? Where are you right now?
I'm good. I'm at home in Atlanta, in my little music office room. I'm good. I'm doing well.
The pianos have to, be a part of that, I guess, right?
I cropped this screen so you don't see all the desk and all the
virtual life. It's amazing, isn't it? I know, it's kind of great. I think I would agree. Most of my things are over there right now. There's actually some stuff that I even hide behind me that you can't see either. So it's just, we used to just call it Facebook life, the thing where you only want people to see what it is that you want them to see, right? And they're sometimes very different lives. And
it's a very curated existence.
exactly. So what are you doing? What are you up to?
These days, teaching. I've been doing a lot of that. I just got back from Washington National Opera. We're recording a few scenes from Fidelio for a virtual reality presentation of Fidelio, which I think is going to be very interesting.
Amazing.
And just teaching. There's a lot of that going on these days.
You're teaching virtually, I assume?
Yes. And sometimes in person in Bloomington when I make trips to IU. Yeah.
So you recently took a position teaching at Indiana University at the Jacobs School of Music. And that, for those of you who don't know, that is a really, really great institution in the opera industry. A lot of really amazing singers come out of there and have for decades, it seems like. So you got that job just at the cusp of the pandemic, right?
Absolutely. So at the end of 2019, I was in Berlin singing my first Forza and from the fall, and I kept getting all these different schools. I don't know what happened. I don't know if someone sent out a memo saying, ask Russell if he wants to teach, but there were a lot of them. And I kept saying, no, I don't want to do that. I don't want to teach at a school. I really don't want to do that. And then they kept asking, and some people came back. And so I decided, okay, let me try it. Let me just go and meet with them. What could it hurt? And I went to IU, I went to Bloomington and met with the dean and the faculty, and it was a great experience, taught a masterclass, and I was still sort of on the fence about it. And then I said, okay, why not? And when I said, okay, why not? That was the beginning of February. Hmm. And I received my contract on February 16th. As I was leaving Houston, I flew back home to Atlanta. I signed the contract and I put it in the mail the next day. COVID started going all over the place. I went to Europe to sing a Beethoven 9. And when I got back to the States, everything was shut down. And they had a hiring freeze right after they got my contract.
Wow. So, wow.
And I'm very lucky and blessed that I had that opportunity and that income, because I would have been, homeless.
Congratulations. No, it's great. Yeah. Everybody seems to be kind of, we're all doing what we can to kind of keep ourselves afloat, and that's a very fortunate thing. I'm happy for you that happened. So you're working with 18-year-olds now. You have master students as well, or
mostly graduate students. I have one freshman. That's a challenge, but but mostly master students. Teaching freshmen, for one thing, they're away from home for the first time ever. I was that guy. I was a guy, I partied a little too much. That's not always the easiest thing. And then there's the recruiting side of things. So I teach a lot of master classes for, high school students and early undergraduate level kids. But it's fun.
So I didn't actually get into opera when I went to college. So when I was about 18 years old, I wanted to be a jazz singer, but you got into opera very early. Am I correct with that assumption?
Yes. No, that's not an assumption. It's very true. I heard opera on the radio when I was about 8. Just as a fluke, I was turning to, before remote controls, you had to go turn the dial, the big silver dial on the radio, and I had to go turn the dial in order to get to the station that I wanted. I passed by, I think it was called WTMI in Miami. It was like classical music during the day, and in the night it was jazz. So I passed through it and I heard these people singing kind of funny, and I
Singing
listened.
kind of funny.
Yeah, I was like, it was, I didn't know what it was. I had no clue what it was. I just heard people singing. And so I went back the next day, and then the next day, and the next day, and I kept listening. And I was hooked. I was absolutely hooked from 8 years old.
Wow. Did you start studying voice earlier
No,
in the
not until college, not until undergrad, not
not until
until
college?
undergrad.
And you went to school in Miami, right?
I went to school in Miami, New World School of the Arts. But when I was a senior in high school, early part of my senior year, I met this wonderful woman, Joy Davidson, who was a professional singer, mezzo, and she heard me sing, and she told me, well, you realize, like 5 minutes into the lesson, she said, you realize if you took voice lessons, you could be an opera singer. And that was all I needed to hear. And that was all I needed to hear, and it changed everything. Changed
Amazing.
absolutely everything.
So then you went out of college and you did a couple of young artist programs.
I did all of the young artist programs. I did young artist programs from started, well, we wouldn't really call Aspen a young artist program, but starting at Aspen in 98 to Opera North in 99 and ending with the Met in 2000. I ended at the Met in two. I started the Met in 2003 and in 2006.
And that's where we met.
Yes, so that was
So
all of the young artist programs.
amazing. And we had Allison on a couple of weeks ago, and we noted that you and Allison and I were the three of that year.
Yeah.
And it's just been wonderful to connect with her and now to reconnect with you after all this time. I just want to say again, I'm really grateful that you're here chatting
Thank
with
you.
us from the halo as well as the personal elements. Thank you. Thanks for being here. So you graduated from Lindemann in 2006, and then it seems like your career has a lot of Verdi going on in it.
Yeah.
How did that come about? I mean, I can stipulate, your voice. I mean, I've heard you sing. I know your voice, and I know that you're perfect for it. But how did it really like manifest in your career?
I really, well, when I was an undergrad, I thought that I should be singing that stuff. And I remember when I auditioned for Marshall Levine, I was singing like, Bohème and all this stuff. And he said, "Can you not sing that stuff anymore and sing only Mozart?" And I said, "Okay." And so when I was in the program, I worked on a lot of Mozart. And right after, as I was leaving the program, all of the first engagements I had were all Mozart roles. And over time, people started asking me more and more to sing things. And I at first it was the Duca, and then there were the smaller things that I did at the Met, like Malcolm in the and the
That one, that Scottish one that shall not be named.
yes and some other smaller parts. And then in 2009, when Muti was there conducting, was at the Met conducting Attila, I was covering, and I was supposed to sing one performance, but it was a performance of Foresta, like that he wasn't conducting. But in the rehearsals, he heard me sing and asked me to sing a performance with him, and told Ramon that he had to be sick one night. And
Amazing.
that was a really amazing thing. And then from there, the offers for the Verdi stuff just started coming more and more and more. So
Wow.
that was sort of the beginning.
Amazing. Well, so we have a clip of you singing Verdi. Now, just folks, so that you know, this isn't, well, I don't know how else to put it. Let's watch the clip first, and then we'll talk about it afterwards. This is Verdi, I think, at its finest, and I think a lot of people would agree. Ashley, if you don't mind playing this clip from Verdi's Requiem, this is the Ingemisco.
Thank you.
What a piece. What a piece. I just
wanted to hear the confutatis.
I know. I mean, the whole piece is just, it's just phenomenal. I often refer to Verdi's Requiem as his greatest opera.
Yeah, it is high drama. It's drama like none. It's perfectly written too. So none of his operas, I don't think, maybe Forza and Falstaff, but none of the operas are as written as well as the Requiem is.
Yeah, and just, you're right. Like dramatically, and how the drama is tied in perfectly with the music and in sync the entire time. It's a gorgeous piece of music. If you haven't, if you're not familiar with the Verdi Requiem, please go and find yourself a recording of it. It's a beautiful piece. One of the issues that I always have with it, with regarding programming it, and maybe I'm just being a bit of a crybaby here, but it's an opera as far as I'm concerned. And the way that a lot of the symphonies and the orchestras program it is that they'll say, okay, we're going to put it on Friday night, we're going to put it on Saturday night, and we're going to put it on Sunday afternoon. So we're basically singing an opera 3 days in a row. And
More,
because we have the dress rehearsal, we have all the rehearsals, you've got the quartet rehearsal that afternoon probably, and then the full rehearsal that night. It's a lot. And I guess the reason why I keep saying that it's an opera is because I want people to treat it like an opera. I don't want people to treat it like just some piece of symphonic work, you know, excuse me. So I'm off my horse now. That was just what I needed to say about the
No, but listen, you're absolutely correct, because I don't remember which performance that was taken from, but we were literally there. I got there, I think, to Barcelona on a Saturday. Rehearsal started Monday. There was, you know, a piano rehearsal Monday morning, first orchestra reading that we were required to attend for whatever reason. Right. And then on Tuesday, there was an orchestra rehearsal at 10 o'clock in the morning.
Right.
On Wednesday, there was an orchestra rehearsal at 10 o'clock in the morning. We had, I think, Thursday off. Then Friday was opening night. We had a rehearsal 10 o'clock in the morning. And then the performance that night. And then, you know, then night matinee. Yeah, it was a lot.
It's just hard. It's just heavy stuff. I mean, so yeah. I'm assuming most of the time when you're not rehearsing, you're like in bed, like I am during those moments.
Usually, especially with that piece. With that piece, there's some of them that, you know, they're hard, but they not that required that kind of attention and detail and the demands vocally to be able to just do all these various things with the voice. And I know most people don't do all of those dynamic markings as they're written in this score, but it's sort of my thing. I feel like I have to.
Yeah. Verdi was pretty articulate with those dynamics.
Yeah.
But he's also amazing at writing these long phrases, these beautiful melodies that you can tell throughout his entire career of writing, he never really walked away from that very much, right? Okay, maybe in Falstaff a little bit, where things started to get kind of, conversational in a sense. But a lot of that comes from his bel canto, his love of bel canto, right? I mean, we can even argue that Verdi was a bel canto writer for the earlier part of his life.
Yeah, I think he was a bel canto writer for, you know, the complete part of his life, although the style had changed at the time when he was at his height, you know? Mm-hmm. So the style changed over and over and over again, and he just went along with it, you know? Yeah. Because he sort of had to. So his pieces became more, you know, Otello is more symphonic than Attila, you know,
right.
And the stuff that came before, Oberto, you know.
Yeah. So he actually kind of straddled the line between bel canto and, well, Verdi, because he kind of created his own thing, right?
Right. Yeah. Right. Because he wasn't quite Verismo. I remember there were these, there was a wonderful letter I remember reading years ago where I think he wrote a letter to Puccini saying, be careful with these thick orchestrations that sound like it's a symphonic work or something like that. Yeah. Because, you know, it's not good for the singers. He was telling him.
Exactly. So I mentioned before when I was kind of reading off your mini biography that you are very comfortable singing bel canto music. And it's just, how do they, I mean, they lend a hand easily to each other when you're singing Verdi, when you're singing something like Bellini or something like, I don't know if it's the same for singing Donizetti because they're kind of different bel cantos in a sense there.
I mean that's I sing everything in my opinion, in trying to pay attention to the words and the dynamic markings. And I think that that's pretty much all bel canto is really about, pay attention to to sing what's on the page, and then to find a way to make it individual to yourself. Because as you know, Verdi has this boom chunk chunk dun, 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 and then you have this long line above it that you have to do something with. And that's the same with Donizetti, with Bellini, all of these people. They wanted to sort of get out of the way so the singer can make art with this vocal line that they've created, I sort of approach them all in a similar way. Even singing something like Otello was difficult for me because I wanted to, like, I went through the score, and if my score was in arm's reach, I'd find it for you and show you that, like, everywhere there was a P written or multiple, I highlighted them. And so when I get to rehearsal and I'm singing, and the conductor's like, "Oh, what are you doing? Why are you making this diminuendo there? It's in the score, it's right here." And he's like, "Oh, no one does that. That's usually what you get. Well, no one does that." And I was like, "Well,
Of
I'm
course.
gonna do it. I'm gonna do it because I don't want to kill my voice." But
There's
yeah,
that.
I think it all has to be sort of approached in the same way,
I think so too. I think it's important that yeah, I mean, what I appreciate most is that the way that you deliver it doesn't matter what it is that you're singing, we're ultimately hearing Russell sing it, which is and it's kind of tied into your artistry, but also yourself and your being, which is really it's really wonderful. We have a little clip here from that I'd like to play. This is actually, so the clip is a kind of a teaser trailer for Roberto Devereux that you did in San Francisco, I think in 2019. And I really want you guys to pay close attention to this because you can just, I love watching this clip because you can watch Russell just be Russell in this moment. And it's really amazing. Please enjoy this little clip. I'm sorry it's not longer. It is what it is, but it's fantastic. Those little, where are they? I don't remember. They show up over here on my screen, but
Thank
that's
you.
yeah, I mean, it's just, oh, by the way, guys, before we continue, I just want to say if you guys have any comments or anything, feel free to use the chat section down over here. You can send it to everybody, or you can just send a question to me if you want me to pose a question, and you'd like it to be private, just send it to me directly to the Holy City Arts. So you don't have to, but there are no silly questions. Everything deserves to get asked and everything deserves to get answered if you have any questions. So that, I mean, it's just the amount of control that takes must be, I mean, what are you thinking during those moments? I mean, you seem locked in, right? Vocally, let's just say, like having nothing to do with the character at all.
No, I mean it's more about for me at that moment is well at that moment I'm thinking, oh, that was only the first half. I have a cabaletta to sing. I have a cabaletta to sing with no cuts, two times to do, So I'm thinking about that. For me, those that
Hold
aria.
on, before you go on, 20 seconds for the audience who don't know. So in the bel canto style of writing, when they would write an aria, it would usually be in two parts. There would be the cavatina, which is the first section, which is what he was just singing, and then there would be the cabaletta. And the cabaletta generally is something that has a lot more energy and a lot more drama in it. So what seems to be very difficult to sing in a cavatina actually has nothing compared to what's about to come up in the cabaletta. So when we talk about that, that's where we mean. So, you're just kind of spinning sound and hoping that you're going to get through all this because you're going to have to double down when the cabaletta comes up.
Yeah, and you usually have either a mezzo come in and sing something for 20 seconds,
Right. Give you a little breath.
or a little chorus come in, chorus entry, for about 30 to 60 seconds, and then you have to start singing again. So yeah, that's a lot what's going on in my head right there. And those videos are always taken from like a dress rehearsal in the morning. But anyway, I love that style of music. I absolutely love that style. You can sort of do anything you want. Of course, using what's on the page as a blueprint. And I enjoy it quite a bit.
Well, it seems like you're enjoying it. I love watching you sing that and really anything. So thanks for sharing that. So, in honor of Black History Month, we have been recognizing people of color who've made great contributions to opera and musical theater, and you are definitely one of those people. It's particularly during the pandemic, but also before that, it seemed to me that you have been instrumental in amplifying Black voices in this industry, in the operatic industry. Like I said, particularly during the pandemic, but also before that as well. And you've been working really hard to make that a reality. And so can you talk about that a little bit I mean, we know why, but I'd love to just hear you speak about it a little bit.
Yeah, well, you're right. This is work that I started long before this the George Floyd in the summer of Black Lives Matter this year, because I find that our industry and people in our industry have always sort of had a champion, and unfortunately for Black artists, although we've had some very famous Black singers, but in leadership, we have not had that. So there have not been a lot of people, be it music directors, general directors, artistic directors, that have championed Black artists. So for me, I'm an advocate for artists. I'm not an advocate for Black artists. However, I feel all quite often no one is speaking up for that group of people, And the same thing for Asian artists. And I find myself the same for a doing the same work for Asian artists because I don't feel like enough people are speaking up for them as well. And they're equally or more so discriminated against than Black artists for one reason or another. And it's work that I think is important. There needs to be someone to amplify these voices. There needs to be someone to advocate for them to not just be able to sing, but to also be in leadership. And that's the kind of conversation that I've been trying to have for almost the most of a decade now. And I'm glad that people are starting to finally pay attention to these conversations, or even at least have these conversations, because I think it's very important.
Yeah, and we're seeing some very, very quick changes considering to the industry. At least, in an industry where it's, we perform art that's 250, 300 years old, it's been around, that long. But to see even in the last, 12 months, maybe even 15 months, that there have been some major changes, like Afton Battle over in Fort Worth as general director there. You have this position at LA Opera, which we kind of hinted at before, and you're having a lot of opportunities to use your voice to make a difference with that. And one of the things that I love is that was this programming for the their After Hours series. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, part of the role that Dimitri is talking about is the artist in residence. This summer, when one gig after the next was leaving the calendar, I made a statement that said basically I wanted to, I've been doing so much work to help people get other people get jobs in this business, and I just I said on all of my social media, I think.
So I remember seeing it. I remember the post.
Who's going to give me a job?
Yeah, you know, I remember the post.
I've been working so hard to help other people get jobs. Who's going to give me a job? And with less than 24 hours later, I received an email from LA Opera asking to have a conversation. I was really shocked, but when they said, we've done this artist in residence thing before, because I was saying that I'm willing to give up singing for the right opportunity. I'd love to run the Met program. I would love to run the Lindemann program. I probably would stop singing tomorrow if that was a job that could be mine. Because I think it's, I think I would have something to offer those young artists from my experience. And the general director there said, oh, no. We don't want you to stop singing. We want you to be able to do both. So what happened is we created this role that is in part the company mentoring me with how to run an opera company, from everything from administration to fundraising and everything, all the things that come in between.
Right.
And in turn, I provide them with, a show a season and curating other things. And one of the things that I will curate will be this after hour series that was started by the American composer Matt O'Coin when he was artist in residence.
Right.
And we're starting those programs first virtually, starting with this one that we had just, I think, last week called Black Love, which was basically a Valentine's Day presentation with all songs by Black poets and composers. Which was amazing. And they used their young artists to sing in that concert. The next one would be the music of Latin women, where, we always hear about the music of Latin men. We hardly ever hear about any music from Latin women. Nice. So I've curated an entire program of music of Latin, composed by Latin women. Mm-hmm. Then the third concert in the virtual presentation of After Hours would be songs of protest. So there would be a whole bunch of rep that are protest songs. There would be a huge chunk of Nina Simone, in that group. And there are some young singers from New York that I really admire that I've engaged to sing that concert, and I'm really excited about it.
Right. Yeah. So Black Love premiered on February 13th, and I think we can still go to the website and see it. Go to LA Opera's website, if I'm not correct.
Yeah. LA Opera's website. And I think it's still on their YouTube and Facebook as well.
Great. Amazing. So are you doing also community engaging there? Engagement with LA, with the city?
Or? Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. With LA Opera, there are definitely some community engagement happening. Well, two things that are happening that I'm really excited about. There are two training programs for students from public schools and underfunded schools. Basically, we will identify young singers from these high schools and give them coachings and lessons and basically help them on their way to becoming a professional singer, if that is something that is of interest to them and they have the talent, and we're planning that process right now and starting application process soon. The other is a virtual class that was inspired by Jen Rowley's program that she did for Fort Worth Opera,
right,
where she had young singers come on and she had a panel of experts in the business who coached them or gave them advice on their audition rep. So we're going to be doing some of the same things, but these singers will all be from HBCUs, which is very important to me because I was not a student of HBCU, but there are some really amazing singers at these schools, and their music programs, or at least their voice programs, don't get a lot of funding. Mm-hmm. So they don't have a lot of opportunities to, meet and grow. Mm-hmm. And I'm hoping that this kind of program will give them that opportunity to And a lot of people in the company in the business don't really pay attention to these students at these HBCUs because they know the music programs are usually underfunded, and so they think that they're not any good singers there. But you know, we have so many, like for instance, Leah Hawkins right now, who's coming out and singing everywhere. She was in the Lindemann program, and she's a stunning singer, but she came from an HBCU. And I know that there are so many other singers like her around there that people just aren't paying attention to. So I'm hoping through this program that people will get to know them.
That's great. That's wonderful. Good luck with all of it. I think
Thank you.
I mean, it seems like you've got a pretty full plate up over there on
Yeah,
top of
it's a
your
lot.
IU teaching and on top of your performing. So
Yeah,
it's
there's a lot going
yeah.
on.
I want to ask you a question about because we were talking about how it's an old art form, and there's a lot of opera that is written that is old, and some of it is dated. There is I sent out a quote in the emails that you have on your website, which I think is really amazing. And you talk about how the issue is that people don't think that they can relate to opera. But the fact is that there are so many themes that you can relate to in opera that it's actually really easy if you just give it the opportunity to.
It's not just giving it the opportunity, is programs like this, for instance, where you're taking this kind of information and taking it to the community. And I think a lot of companies don't really engage with the community outside of the people who are already interested in opera. And I think that the thing that has to happen is an education of the public, because as we know, music in schools started disappearing maybe 20 years ago. So these people who are adults now, who have no clue what music is and what opera is and what classical music is, no clue if they would even like it because they haven't been exposed to it. So programs like this one and other community programs at some opera companies are trying to change that and move that needle. But I think that people just have to know it's there, know it's available to them, and they'll get it that it's, you know, it's not just every, I've never seen one opera that didn't have something that could be related to today. Not one. Even the fanciful ones. There's something in that opera that could have something to do with the way we experience life today.
So, what about the operas that are posing problems in the industry nowadays? What kind of, let me ask you a different way. What kind of pieces should we be doing that would demonstrate diversity very well, for example? Because there are some things where, like a lot of time, like lately, Madame Butterfly has been on the chopping block, because we because people are offended that somebody is trying to look more Asian than they actually are, And then the other side of the coin, of course, is of the coin is, the Othello question at hand, which is, Othello is a Moor and therefore he should be black. And anybody that's trying to make themselves black isn't doing, I mean, that's just silly. So maybe we don't have to answer those questions, but I'd like to know from you, like, what do you think we could do that would de demonstrate, that would allow diversity to be on stage without any issues at all?
I think cast people of different races and creeds and colors on stage. I mean, you don't have to stop doing a specific opera. I think here's the thing. And this is a bit of a controversial statement, but I'll try to be quick.
You controversial?
Black people aren't having the conversation about blackface. It's white people having the conversation about blackface. Now, it's different for Asian artists because I find that Asian artists feel that it's disrespectful. Black people, some younger black singers and black people do feel like, oh, it's blackface to paint this white guy to be, or to paint this white woman to be Aida, you know? But I think we have to be very careful with the term blackface because it's something very specific. To make up somebody to look like a character is not blackface, it's makeup. If you're engaging in minstrelsy, which is what blackface is, that's something that's completely different. And unfortunately, if we start having this conversation about what should we do, which opera should we do to be diverse, you're basically saying that I can't sing Don Carlo, I can't sing Forza del Destino, I can only sing the characters that are written for black characters, and there are very few of those. And the minority artists will always lose. Will always lose. So Are you going to go find a Spanish singer to sing Don Carlo? Are you or are you going to go find, only
Where's
H?
the line? Where's the
Yeah.
line?
Where's the line? And I think this is something we have to be very careful about. Because what happens is we begin typecasting, and then we start producing black operas, Latino operas, Asian operas, and then what happens to the standard repertory? Do I no longer get the opportunity to sing it? Am I not going to be able to sing Calaf because I'm not Asian? We don't even really know where he's from, but the entire theme is very Asian. Am I going to not be able to sing Calaf because I'm not Asian? Will we have not gotten Leontine Price's Butterfly if people took that stance?
Exactly.
Imagine a world without Leontine Price's Butterfly.
I don't want to.
Well, anyway, we have to be very careful with that. I think what a lot of companies are doing is they are producing more modern operas, they're commissioning more operas. But unfortunately, those then become the black operas, the Asian operas, the Latino operas. And I think we have to that is going to set us back and not move us forward. And in the end, everybody just wants there to be equity. I'm sorry, that's my somebody's in near my house. That's my ring. Everybody just wants in the end equity, but we all have different ideas of how we can go about doing that.
I just, there's always it's this, we kind of go in circles around the same questions. We talk about, Otello, we talk about Porgy and Bess, we talk about Madame Butterfly. And I certainly don't agree that, there was a company, I think, in Norway that did an all white Porgy and Bess a couple of years ago.
Hungary. Somebody put it down.
Hungary.
Yeah, Hungary. Yeah.
It was
And you
Hungary.
know what? And it was all
Thank you,
white, but
cast.
it made everybody look like very ethnic because they put, dreadlocks in some people's hair, and they did a whole bunch of things that were, again, that's a bit edging towards minstrelsy. You know what I mean? They didn't just give people a tan. And the Gershwin estate says that they shouldn't do that. So they're going against the composer's wishes. But Verdi said that this character was a Moor. And this character is Ethiopian. And, although I love some of my colleagues, it's really weird to be on stage with, a blonde Aida. It's really weird because she's supposed to be the one person on that stage that is specific to Ethiopia. We can debate what an Egyptian looks like. We can debate how brown an Egyptian is. But she's an Ethiopian princess, and her father is Ethiopian as well. Do we sort of whitewash, for lack of better verbiage, the presentation of opera, and we shouldn't do that.
Do you think our industry would lean towards a bit of a Bridgerton syndrome? I just made that up. I don't know if that's even a thing or not. A lot of, for those of you who do know or don't know, there's a show on Netflix by Shonda Rhimes called Bridgerton, and basically it's a period show that takes place in the in Victorian times or 1800s, 1700s, around there. But race is not an issue at all. It's just, it doesn't matter what kind of person you were, how much money you had, your class, your vocation, none of that stuff. There's just no attention paid to it at all. Would we as an industry benefit from that at all? And how long would it take before we get someplace like there? Or maybe we won't. I don't know.
I mean, I think we should, and I think we can, and I think we are going towards that. But I think again, the conversations need to be framed in a way that is not about makeup, because essentially, what everybody wants is equity, But we should also, and this is the red and right side of me, we should not make it about affirmative action. Classical art should not be affirmative action. We shouldn't say we need five Latinos, five blacks, five white. That is not what it is. That's also taking it and doing something else with it.
At the end of the day, as a producer, wouldn't you want to put the best talent that you can put on your
There
stage?
you go. There you go. And I think that the what most black artists are saying, and Latino and Asian artists as well, is give us an opportunity to be there as well. Don't block us from the opportunity. And I think that's essentially what everybody needs to do. not to, again, not to make an affirmative action art form, because it's never going to work that way, because the quality is more important. But don't block specific people, you know? Don't block an Asian artist, don't block a Latino artist because of your own bias. And we all have biases. We all have biases, but you have to be willing to put those biases aside to give everybody an opportunity, or to at least listen with that in mind, and not say, oh, well, if we have a black Don Carlo, we have to have a black Filippo. Listen, one of the
I
first
was
times
in
I
that
met Don Carlo.
production. We did that same production together. The one,
Yes. Yeah, one of the first Don Carlos I ever did, I think, was my daddy was Hans Peter Koenig. You know, couldn't be any more
White.
whiter than me. And it was a great show. It
Yeah.
was an absolutely amazing show.
We're asking our audiences, we're already asking our audiences to suspend disbelief, right? We're asking them to imagine that what's happening on that stage behind that proscenium is a world that they're just peering into. So if we're
Yes.
already going there with it, why can't we go the next step and saying there's no reason why this white man can't be the father of this black son? It's
Yes.
just,
There's
I
absolutely
don't
no.
get it. I don't get it.
I don't either. I don't either. But I think that's what we need to do. And it is difficult. But I think also you mentioned Madame Butterfly earlier. I think a retelling of that story is just about sex trafficking. And
In
right. So she
a
doesn't have
very romantic way.
to be. She doesn't have to be Asian.
Yeah.
She doesn't have to be Asian, you know.
But there's so much reference to Nagasaki and the port and
Yes,
the time period and
because that's the location. But the wonderful thing about art is that you can take that piece and make it about anywhere.
right. We know Nagasaki being in Japan, but there's no reason
Yes.
that once it's beyond the proscenium, it can't be in Nagasaki
How
anywhere
many
in any
times do we
parallel
need to see
universe.
how many times do we need to see shoji screens, and how many times do we need to see it that what if and this is one of these things that again, a very interesting idea that I have for a butterfly is that it's taking place during the Civil War, and that butterfly is a black woman that this white soldier is coming to take refuge in this place, maybe in the north, who knows? And maybe he's a Confederate soldier, who knows? Who knows? Again, we opera is
Somebody,
not
somebody's
about
mind's being blown up over
right.
there above.
Opera is not about mu a museum. Opera is not a an opera is not a museum art form. If you want a
It's
museum
a
art form,
live art form.
you paint a picture and you put it on the wall, and it never has to change. But that is never what opera was intended to be, and it's unfortunate that people don't use their imagination to try to do other things. But if I had $1 million, I'd put on a butterfly in the Civil War. And I would definitely do it. And I think it would be a huge hit.
I think so too. I think so too.
Yeah.
We're getting close to the time here, and I could talk to you about this forever, but I have
Oh
one
gosh,
more. You got to go somewhere too. I have one more
yes.
amazing clip that I want to play for you. If you want to set this up, this is from a house recital that occurred towards the beginning of the pandemic. Yeah.
No, it was actually, well, it was in the summer. It was
Oh, it was
after
the
the game.
summer. Okay.
I was asked to.
Pandemic life is like, everything could be last week
Right.
or it could be eight
We
months.
don't know
It's all
where it
the
is.
same, right?
Right.
It's
Yes. We
Blur's
don't know
Day,
where
as
it
far as
is.
I'm concerned.
I think that what happened was I was asked to sing quite a bit, and I couldn't bring myself to it. I was probably depressed, but I just did not enjoy singing. And when I started working and learning music to try to work my voice back up, I started singing music that I loved, and this song was one of those songs that I absolutely love. And I said the only way I would sing on this recital is if I could sing this song.
Amazing. And the song is
Strange Fruit.
Strange Fruit. Billie Holiday, Nina Simone, take your pick. I mean, anybody that sang it is just amazing. And here's another amazing version. This is Strange Fruit from a house recital from this summer with Russell.
Right there.
Southern trees strange fruit. Blood on the leaves and blood at the root. Black body swinging in a southern breeze. Strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees.
That's depressing, Dimitri.
It's depressing, but it's necessary, is it not? I mean,
it's one of my favorite songs. It's probably all time favorite song. Just, yeah. And it was, unfortunately, it was so necessary this summer to sing it, but it's just one of those things.
Well, thank you for that. Thank you for, I mean, just, I mean, I've heard the song so many times, but I've never seen it performed, I guess I could say. So Strange Fruit, I mean, even just the, you know, the use of the word crow, you know, talking about the Jim Crow era, having the double entendre. I mean, there's just so much to unpack in that song. It's like another, we have another class for that almost, right?
right.
Russell, I can't thank you much enough for being here today, for sharing all of your thoughts and ideas and your artistry. We really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you for having me. Thank you so
much. My pleasure. Folks, that's about it for today. I want to remind you again, for those of you who came on a little bit late, first of all, that was Russell Thomas, tenor. Go find him. Go follow him. We will not have class next week, March 2nd, but we will be back the following week. So we look forward to seeing you back then. Enjoy the rest of your Tuesday. Enjoy the rest of your week this week and next. Russell, thank you so much. Thank you, Ashley, our technical director for Opera 101. And it's great. It's great to see you, Russell. Thank you for everything. Good luck with everything. Stay safe, stay healthy. And same for all you guys out there. Stay healthy, stay safe, and we'll see you guys in a few weeks. Thanks, everybody.